Well, I have been in the public service for 36 years. In fact, I should have retired when I am 60, but I am 63. But Secretary to the President does not have a retiring age. So he goes on at the will and pleasure of the President. So until the President tells me, go home, I will have to be in this job. That is what I am doing now. But let me say, I joined the public service in 1977. But after having worked 3 years in the private sector, I joined Haley's as a management trainee, probably at your age. I was about 23 or 24 at that time. My background is natural sciences, funny combination, physics, chemistry and botany was my first degree. But later on, I also did a master's in business administration. I had a very interesting opportunity to go to the US as a Hubert Humphrey Fellow, which is a one-year program where you don't study for a degree, but you learn. So that's when I was around 48, mid-career professional. Very quickly to run through, I started as a assistant controller of immigration. Then I have gone to district administration and I was an assistant government agent. Later on, I moved on to the Ministry of Youth Affairs and handled vocational training and youth activities. So I generally understand how young people behave, young people's aspirations. Maybe currently a little bit outdated, but I do understand their aspirations. From there onwards, I quickly moved on to the Prime Minister's office. Mrs. Bandaranaike wanted me to come as her additional secretary in 1994. From that time onwards, I've been either in the Prime Minister's office or the Presidential Secretariat, except for a brief period where I was also the additional secretary in the Ministry of Education and Higher Education in charge of policy. One of my most interesting things in my career is that I was also able to work as an expert in vocational training for the International Labour Organization in Bangkok. So that gave me what I would call international management experience. From time to time I have worked as consultant to the UNDP on youth affairs and rural development and things like that. But basically held a large number of appointments in the public service. You might ask why I moved from the private sector to the public service. Even at that time, the private sector had better salaries and better opportunities. But I always thought for me to do something useful, not to just earn money, the best place is the government. So that is why I joined the SLAs. SLAs, as you know, is a competitive exam. In 1975 was the year that I sat the exam. But finally, when we were recruited, it was in 77 January. So from 77 January up to now, I have served in many sectors, even in Ayurveda. No, I don't know anything about Ayurveda, but I was taken in as a kind of a expert on management, and I was to set up the National Institute of Traditional Medicine. It's all about management, nothing to do with Ayurveda. But that also gave me a good understanding of what indigenous medicine is, which is quite important. Now today we are talking about the strengths of our country. These are some of the strengths that we have not capitalized on. I think people like you who do management must also see how our indigenous health system was managed by the Vedamahatya in the village. He was one man show, but he had everything under his management sphere. So basically this is what I have been doing in government. But one of my most I would say memorable things in life is I have been able to bring ICT into government as a major tool. I have no experience as an ICT programmer or whatever. I never learned programming. I only know how to use a computer for my own purposes, and that is good enough. But I think basically I have understood what it can do to a government. So that is why you see sometimes today a lot of e-government initiatives are now taking shape. They are bringing good benefits to the people. Basically, we have also got people interested in studying ICT. I see a lot of IT faculties now, but maybe we'll be talking about it later on. So I will probably stop at that. So that's basically little about myself. There are many things that I want to say, but I think that's not the time for me to enlarge on what I have done in life. So basically this is something that might be useful. I am a strong believer in teamwork. I never believe that I am the only person who can do things. That's part of my being able to, I don't know whether people call it successful, but that is part of my ability to do lot of things. I have always given credit to others, not bothered about whether I get credit or not. One of the major obstacles in management may not be in books, but if you really start becoming an executive, a young executive, someone who will want to do something, you will find that if you start worrying about credit, meaning, you know, you like to get recognition, I think you will not go a long way. But if you forget about recognition and just do what you have to do, that's the secret of success of whatever I have done. Never bothered whether someone will give me a certificate or honorary degree. No, I don't bother about those things. I only bother about, I have my own measurements. Like, if I want to do something, I will say, these are the success factors of what I do. If I can get to those, well, why should I worry about others giving me credit? I don't need to. I don't want people to write or maybe do felicitations. I'm simply not bothered. Even if someone were to say, look, I am the one who did it when I am the one who really have done it, I don't bother about it. So what is it? You all do it for your fellow beings. So one of the things is that, the second thing is that you must have faith in others. You must always believe that here are people who can do things. But if you start picking faults in people, everybody has faults. I must be having hundreds. So if you start thinking about faults in others, you will never go a long way. Thirdly, one of the success factors that I believe which has made me come up to this point, I think being a Secretary to the President is a very tough job, very tough, very demanding. There is no kind of holiday or whatever, vacation. You just go on working. The country wants you to work and you work. One other reason I would call myself at least being able to do many things is that I keep on learning. I don't stop learning. Frankly, I don't have to sit any exam. Why should I? I mean, I don't need to go anywhere beyond this. But I, not to sit exam, but I read books, I read journals. There are young people who are very good at computing today, extremely good. I don't mind a young fellow teaching me something and saying, sir, I should do it this way, this is the way to do it. But some people don't. Adults don't like to be taught, especially at my level. But I love to. I will go and sit in a class, if there is some renowned lecturer speaking, I'll go and even take down notes. Because that's for you to improve yourself. So keep on improving yourself. If you think that you have reached excellence, that is the end of your career. But if you think there's a lot more to learn, well, you know, you go in search of knowledge, you go in search of excellence, you go in search of doing things better, you want to refine what you do. Now, some of these technological things. Now, the phone company through which I use my mobile, they will always bring me the most modern phone, which young people use, and say, would you like to try this? Try this. I will certainly take it and I'll try it. And take maybe about 2-3 hours to figure it out, but I will use all the applications in it. I use an iPad. I will always use the most modern iPad. The other day they brought me a new laptop. It's a touch screen and also it's very sophisticated. I just started using it. So, but I'm learning. If I get stuck, I will phone them and ask, you know, I got stuck here, what do I do? So never feel bad to learn from anyone. I will learn from anyone, doesn't matter. It doesn't have to be a professor. If someone has knowledge, why not? So that's, I think, the fourth success factor. Maybe those are the major things. Being Secretary President is also the, it's a foremost civil servant position, no doubt. But head of the Sri Lanka Administrative Service, no. Sri Lanka Administrative Service is one other all island services, there are nine. Head of the Sri Lanka Administrative Service is Secretary Minister of the Public Administration and Home Affairs. So I don't need to take that hat. generally, the Secretary of the President is regarded as the head of the public service, the entire public service. I would tell anyone who asks me this question, how do I manage all these people? I think it is through delegation. A cardinal principle in management is to delegate, but not to abdicate. Two different things. You can delegate, and if you abdicate, that means you just given it to someone else and you are not bothered about it. No. You delegate, but you are responsible. I can't tell His Excellency the President, look, I gave it to my additional secretary, I don't know. I will give it to an additional secretary, but I take the full responsibility if anything goes wrong. That is what it should be. So my relationships are based on trust. I fully believe in people. I trust they don't cheat until they cheat. Well, if they cheat, that's a different issue. You need to take disciplinary action as a boss. I am never known as a tough boss, but I am known as a very friendly boss. Because I think it's all human relationships. Now, if people are personally attached to me, I think that's a very nice way of seeing things. But if they are officially attached to me, they will finish their job and they will just do it and get away. If they are personally attached, like a friend, they will say, oh my God, this is my boss, I like to work for him. I must do the best for him. So in order to get that output from them, you need to believe in them. You need to trust them. And also ensure that they learn. Now, there are opportunities for people to go abroad and do their master's degrees, PhDs. I really love to see those people studying and even doing better than I am. I always tell them, if I can see my subordinates having PhDs, I would love it. I don't have time to do a PhD. I don't think it's time for me to now sit down and start writing. So I am not really into it, but I like people who are studying. Managing relationships, I think you all should, as management students. One of the books that made me change a lot is having read Stephen Covey's 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. That's the book every management student should read. I have in fact attended a workshop, a 5-day workshop in the US. It makes you understand what people are capable of, how you manage relationships, how you build trust, how you find your time. Now there's a very important principle. If you look at the 7 habits, the 3rd habit is, I think, if I remember right, the first things first. Meaning, how do you manage your time? In our job, it is very demanding. I must know what my priorities are. So I have a way of categorizing my work, like urgent and important, maybe not urgent but important, meaning I can, you know, put aside. Urgent and important, I have to do it now, today. I have to finish it today. So you need to have your staff understand your style of work. My style of management, as I told you, is delegation. I trust people. I want them to develop. But I also, I'm also seen as a hard taskmaster, meaning if there is even a single mistake in a letter that is put up to me, I will send it back. I'm not going to sign it. Or, you know, maybe correct it. No, I will correct it. But I'll say, no, redo it. I don't want anyone reading a letter that I have signed. The mistakes here, full stop is not there, the comma is not there, the date is wrong, maybe wrong spellings. If I use British spellings, I will use throughout my letter British spellings. For instance, people write program, P-R-O-G-R-A-M. But I will always use B-R-A-M-M-E in English, UK. So that is consistency. Now your people will also know then to be consistent. So to handle high-level responsibilities, I think you also must understand principles of management and motivation. If you don't know how to motivate your staff, employees, you can't get work out of it. How do you motivate? My way of motivating is you have to recognize what they do. I am not bothered about whether people recognize me or not, but others do. So I always think, look, if someone does well, I will always write it and say, congratulations, this is fantastic what you have done. This is the kind of work that I expect. I will also say, you know, keep on developing yourself. People read my minutes sometimes, send me an email and say, you know, thank you very much, I never expected from a person like you to have so much of work. And that's how work is all about. So even if you have tens of thousands of people, it's all delegated, but you meet certain layers regularly. I have regular meetings with them. Meetings are not hours and hours. Meetings are just cut 1 hour, 1.5 hour, 1 hour, 15 minutes with very clear objectives, a very clear agenda, and you listen to them and then you offer whatever you can offer by way of solution. But important thing is listening. So one way of handling a large number of people is also to listen to them. Most bosses are not good listeners. So as a result, they come and tell you something, you start telling them, no, you must just listen to them. And then say, this is what I feel about it, so this is the way to go about it, or this is the authority under which you should act, or you should, say, no, I want it on such and such a date, having fully understood that they can deliver it. So basically that's the kind of work that I do. Not because the Telecom Regulatory Commission has been doing, not the only reason why we have been doing some good work, but I think the most important thing is that today communication is extremely important. We have 20 million people, 21 million telephone connections, 18 million mobile phones, 3 million land phones. So you can understand everybody carries a mobile. Some people carry two mobiles. Why? You want to communicate in different ways. Some people have dedicated, okay, I will contact through this number, such a number of people. Others, maybe through the other phone. So, many things, purely because communication is expanding. There is no development in a country without two things. One is peace, the other is communication. So, communications have grown so much during the last 3 to 4 years, particularly because now every part of the country is reachable. You know, you can have telephone towers and whatnot. ICT also has helped a lot. Today people are using smartphones. People are using a lot of ICT equipment. Laptops, desktops, iTabs, or whatever, you know, many things. Mini tabs and whatever you call them. iPads, handhelds, all sorts of things. Even telephones are like computers today. So basically, Telecom Regulatory Commission has been able to have a, what I would call a field of fair play or a level playing field, so that we have five major telecom providers, from Sri Lanka Telecom to the newest one is Airtel. But you have to have a level playing field so that they can operate well. If you start regulating more or making tough rules, then the industry doesn't grow. But if you don't have rules, then what happens is everybody will do whatever they want. That is not good for a country. So there is national security that is involved. We are very concerned about national security, whether telephones will be used for crime, whether telephones will be used for terrorist activities. As you would have known, the terrorists used telecom equipment. Terrorists used mobile phones even to set off bombs. It's very quite possible. You all need, what you need is a signal. So basically, I would say that the last 4 or 5 years have seen tremendous progress in telecom development, but it's not limited to Sri Lanka. If you go to any developing country, you see telecom is developing, where people want to communicate. And when equipment becomes cheap and telephone lines become cheap to get, naturally people will go for a phone. Today people are using phones for all sorts of reasons. But those days it was mainly important. You had a landphone at home, or you wanted to contact someone. Today people used to chat, and you know, they will ask all sorts of things. And even if you go to the market, and then you use the phone to ask, what should I bring from the market from your wife, or the other way about. So totally unnecessary in my understanding. You have to plan your day and get things done. So I think telecommunication is doing very well. I am chairman of the Telecom Regulatory Commission as an ex officio position, because the TRC comes under Presidential Secretariat. Then the Act says the chairman of the Telecom Regulatory Commission shall be the secretary of that particular ministry. So the Presidential Secretariat is the ministry here. So as the secretary of the Presidential Secretariat, I become its chairman as well. So as long as this is there under the President's office, it will always be the secretary to the President who will be the chairman of the TRC. Today, Sri Lanka is known in the Asian region as a country which is forging ahead in ICT development, in all aspects of ICT. But the rural telecenter network is the brainchild of the President. In 2004, when he became the Prime Minister, this subject of ICT was given to him. I still remember the day when he asked me, how do we give internet and computers to the rural children? That was the question. So we had to come up with a strategy and tell him this is the way to do it. Then he said, no, I don't think you will ever be able to achieve it this way. Use temples, mosques, kovils and churches, and go and set up your rural telecenters in those. I was taken aback. I was wondering as to why he is saying this. He said, you don't have to use money for buildings. Very simple. So you use money only for computers and the internet. That's it. Even the instructor, if you want to have an instructor or someone to guide, a facilitator, he said the temple can find someone. And that is how today we have 750 nanosolars. But as you know, I don't know whether you are aware of this, his plan is to have 14,000 nanosolars. That is, we have 14,000 Gram Seva Niladari divisions. So for each Gram Seva Niladari division, which might have about say 5,000, 7,000 people, some are bigger, some are smaller, to have a rural telecenter there. So we will have to find a temple or a mosque or a church or a Hindu Kovil or whatever, or any other social service organization to which we will give the computers. Some nanosolars have 5, some have 10, some have 15. Some are self-earning. Some have become, as you know, the telecenter manager in Surya rather, became the best telecenter, one of the best telecenter managers in the whole world. He won an award in Barcelona, in Spain. So you have things like that. But basically the whole idea is to take ICT to the rural community, so that the rural child who is unable to come to a city school will not feel disadvantaged. That rural child will also learn ICT, use ICT for his job, maybe use ICT for business, and even rural communities can use ICTs, like say they have their own web page, they have their own kind of, you know, product marketing through the webs, all sorts of things you can do with web pages. So that's the kind of philosophy we have. But we believe by 2016 we must see an IT literacy of 75%. Today's ICT literacy is around 40%. But when we took over, when President Rajapaksa was the Prime Minister in 2004, ICT literacy was less than 3%. That means 3% of the population, less than 3% of the population could handle ICT. ICT definition is also important. It is not having a computer. It is being able to use a keyboard effectively, doing various things. So if you can even use a smartphone, that is ICT savvy. So that is the definition that the Department of Census and Statistics uses. So that's how we see ICT being developed in Sri Lanka. Since we are debating this very much, there will be threats, no doubt. There is already a threat of environmental pollution. Where do we throw all these computers? Because they are not biodegradable. So how do you manage? So computer waste is a huge issue. In a country which has only 25,000 square miles or 65,000 square kilometers, where do we go and dump this? You can't dump them into the sea. You can't burn them. How do you do that? So e-waste is a very important aspect. Second is, through ICTs you can also have social upheavals, like you have in Egypt, in the countries that you have had, because people are used to social media. So countries need to be very careful about it. You can't stop. You can't have pressure on the people and say, don't use it. Then why are you promoting these things? The whole idea is to be aware and to make sure that you are able to, if there is a threat, you are able to counter it. You have to do it in many ways. One, you have to technologically counter it. So you have to have what are called ICT centers of excellence. Like we have this Sri Lanka CERT. Sri Lanka CERT, if you do visit one day, it is at the World Trade Center. There they have a team which is dedicated with highly qualified people who will understand computer crime, who will understand if there are threats from outside to our network. You know, there are many networks in the country. There is a Lanka government network which connects all the government offices. Then there are other private networks. So you have many things doing. There are intranets also. So all these things can be a threat. So basically, to be aware of what threats can be, and also to make sure that you have people to handle them. I think Sri Lanka is able to handle it because we have people. I don't think we have ever run short of people. Because our IT education, I wouldn't say is the excellent one, but I think IT education can improve. But IT education up to now is very good. So we have enough and more people, but we don't produce enough software engineers that the industry needs. That is one reason why the BPO sector, the ICT sector is not growing. When investors want to come to Sri Lanka, they ask, how many graduates do you produce in IT? Far too low. We should be producing about 10,000 graduates a year, 10,000 IT graduates a year. I think we barely produce about 1,000 IT. That's a rough figure that I have. So Sri Lanka is aware of the kind of threat, but I think we should be able to manage. I'm confident, I don't know. I'm not in charge of the ICT sector anyway. I am only what is called a godfather of ICT. Yeah, supporting, promoting, making sure that people use ICT. There is a ministry for ICT, telecommunication IT. Then you have the ICT agency of Sri Lanka, of which I was one of the founder directors. So you have many agencies, so they will probably look after these things. Because you take any job today, any job that is of high value, or jobs that even I wouldn't say they pay a hell of a lot, but even some of the simple jobs need the ability to use a computer, ability to use a keyboard, ability to use a screen, read the instructions out of a screen. So ICT education is extremely important if we are to forge ahead. If you take countries like Korea, Japan, Vietnam, Thailand, I'm not talking about the West, but just taking the Asian countries which are really developing fast, they have gone ahead by teaching their children. Even if you take a 2-year-old child, that child is ICT savvy, no matter keyboard is. So by the time they are in grade 1, grade 2, they can use a computer for games. They will use all sorts of programs which are not very difficult ones, very user-friendly ones, but they know how to use it. So by the time you get to the secondary school, You use your computer to take notes and maybe to use databases, Excel sheets, whatever. So ICT education is something that will make our young people very competitive in the world. Now, if our young people think like you, if you think, you know, I'm just employed in Sri Lanka, I don't think that's that is how you shouldn't think like that. You should think beyond. You should think, okay, we must find good employment elsewhere in the world. But how do you do this? You have to have what are called global skills. Global skills are today ICT, English language abilities, maybe another foreign language, business skills, and maybe soft skills like people skills, how do you manage people, what I was talking about earlier. So these are areas in which our education system must be enriched with. What is this particular thing that you all were? There are, well, I will tell you, there is ICT ministry. Then you have the ICT agency of Sri Lanka, which is a very special organization set up by the government, by an act of parliament, which is charged with developing the ICT infrastructure, ICT knowledge capacities, ICT personnel, private sector ICT growth. All these things are under the charge of that particular act. So I don't know whether you are referring to that. If that is the case, well, ICT agency is the most important agency where ICT is concerned. But you have this Ministry of Telecommunication and IT. It was created only recently in 2010. Earlier we did not have that. If the ICT agency was under us, under the Presidential Secretariat. But I don't know whether you are referring to something else. There is this ICT committee of the Asia and Pacific, of which Sri Lanka was the chair for three consecutive terms. I was its chair for three consecutive terms, the whole of Asia and Pacific. That is an ICT expert committee which looks at ICT growth in the area, in whole of the Asia Pacific area, huge, large number of countries. And that is where Sri Lanka was given a lot of recognition for what we have done. They think we have forged ahead in e-government. You know, you have Korea and Japan which are doing extremely well in ICT. They, for everything they do, they have robots, they have all sorts of ICT use in machinery and even running homes. There are people who do remote controlling of their homes. They switch off the fridge, they switch on the fridge from somewhere else. All that is far too sophisticated for us. But in terms of development, in terms of growth, I think Sri Lanka was recognized because of the rural telecentre network, of the e-government initiatives, and I think the fact that we are having a goal of trying to reach ICT literacy of 75% by 2016, they liked it very much. Not many countries have that kind of goal. They may be teaching, but they don't have a goal like that. We have a goal because in the Mahindra Chintana, one of the things that the president wanted was, please put a figure and say, which year will you reach what? So we debated, we talked, we looked at what is available, we looked at schools, we looked at different colleges, we looked at universities and all these things, and we said, okay, by 2016 we should be able to reach 75% ICT literacy. That is how this figure came about. So if you are referring to the ICT committee, in my understanding, I think what you are referring to must be the ICT agency. You may have to correct that question. It's gradually increasing, but it can't suddenly give large amounts because I don't think the Ministry of Higher Education and the universities can absorb it. Now, if the government gives tomorrow double the money and say, okay, increase the ICT student intake, universities can't do that. Universities will have to build the laboratories, university will have to have staff for so many students, so many lecturers, so many software guys, So it has to be done over a period of time. And I think government is putting in enough money. But the point is, how fast do you utilize this money? So the ministries and the universities will have to sit down and have a plan of their own. And I'm aware that the Minister of Higher Education, Honorable Wilson Nayaka, and Dr. Sunil Navaratna, who is the Secretary of the Ministry, they have huge plans for ICT. And I think those are fully endorsed by the government. And whatever plans that they can give to the Treasury, the Treasury will have to allocate money, they will find the money. Now, when the Treasury Secretary came up with this whole idea of improving ICT literacy, it is the President who said, look, let us have 14,000 nanosolars in this country. So it is just about to be launched, locating places, locating resource persons, where do we really go and put these computers. There is no point in putting a computer unless we have the right software, right programs, right content, language, whether it is in Sinhala, Tamil or English, whether it is area specific or whether it is national level. So many issues to be looked at, but I think we are on the right path. Maybe a little bit slow, but I think I believe in being slow and steady rather than, you know, running fast and getting burnt out. And finally at the end of the day, there's nothing. So maybe we'll go slowly. Mahindra Chintana vision for the future, that is the second Mahindra Chintana which the President presented in 2010 when he was a candidate, it talks of 5 hubs. Already you are seeing now, yesterday when the Colombo harbour was opened, that is part of the work that was envisaged. If we are becoming a maritime and naval hub, well, you have to have a harbour which can accommodate large ships and be in the centre, because we are in that what is called the Silk Route. So, and major international maritime lanes all pass through Sri Lanka. That is why you have one in Hambantota and one in Colombo, the harbour. Then we have the second airport. So aviation hub is being taken care of. These are only the starts, you know. Tomorrow you can't become a hub. It's so difficult. It takes a little bit of time. Then power and energy. We are a commerce hub, but most importantly, a knowledge hub. So ICT comes into that part of that knowledge hub. It is part of the knowledge that the people will seek from Sri Lanka. So today, if you ask some of the ICT companies, they like to come here. They like to come here because of the personnel. They say it's much easier to work with Sri Lankans than some of the other nationalities elsewhere in this part of the world. They think we are pleasant, we learn very quickly, we are not that demanding. They are not people who will unnecessarily call for facilities which they cannot provide. Because, you know, you must remember, for a commercial entity to be viable, they can't have recurring costs or recurrent expenditure which is far above the industry norms or norms in the world. They can only have what are called standards, which they are if you go to another country, that's the kind of expenditure that they will have. So you can't expect high expenditure here. But the good thing about Sri Lanka is that recurrent expenditure or day-to-day expenditure is low compared to many other countries. So we are not paying very high wages, but we are paying fairly good, okay, wages are okay. One thing we may lack would be, as I told you earlier, enough IT personnel. We need more software engineers, more programmers, more BPO workers. If you start looking at, maybe because the way we pronounce English, they may not want to hire us. But if you go to Philippines, they speak English, which is generally acceptable to many in the world. There are many American customers from North America, from Canada, who will access these call centers. So when they are called, and if our accent is not understood, then there's a big problem. Because for a BPO, it doesn't matter where it is. BPO, what matters is what is being said. So whether it is in Sri Lanka, they don't know where this is when they call. And suddenly you call 1-800 numbers, it may not be in the US or it may not be in Canada, it may be somewhere else in Mongolia or somewhere. So basically that is an issue. So one of the things that Sri Lanka is very keen to develop is a knowledge hub. But a hub is not something where you only generate knowledge. You have to bring knowledge also. You have to learn from outside and bring knowledge. You have to give knowledge out. That's a hub, no? The whole idea of a hub is exchange. You come in, you go out. Not only coming in, no, not only going out. You have to have both. It's like a junction on the road. If you go to a roundabout, that's a kind of a hub from all directions. So what we are trying to do is to offer what we have, indigenous knowledge, borrow knowledge which is useful to Sri Lanka and give it to others. Make it a place where any student can come here and learn. Conditions are very good, charges are not high, our teaching is good. And I think one of the most important things is that from a university perspective, is our universities have to become much better than what they are today. We have to become world-class universities, in short. But if you take the world-class rankings, we are nowhere. So that is why Honorable S.B. Sanayak and the Ministry of Higher Education is trying their level best to at least come to, you know, maybe first 500 or first 1000 or whatever. So that, you know, when you look at the first 500 best universities in the world, Sri Lanka is also somewhere there, one of the campuses, or rather one of the universities we have, either your university or Colombo University or Caledonia or Moroto or whatever, has to come within those 500, and then only it can become a hub. If you look at those countries which have moved forward, like Korea, Japan, even Vietnam, they put a fair amount of money into research and development. It has to be a kind of a percentage of the GDP. If you look at the percentage of research and development funding in regard to GDP, vis-a-vis the GDP, it's very low. It's, I think, something like 0.01 or something like that. Now, if you take a country like Korea, it's 14%, 15%, 16%. So, unless you put money into research and development, and researchers are well paid, if a researcher is paid very low salaries, no one is going to do research. So we have lost a lot of good researchers because we are not competitive. Government can't be paying high salaries because everybody then has to be paid. So we don't get the best researchers within government. So it is the private sector which will have to involve themselves and put a little bit of more money into R&D. And I think that's the only way to get about. But already some of the IT companies are doing that, but not enough. So maybe the government will have to help, or maybe the government will have to partner the private sector and say public-private partnership, and then make sure that R&D activities are taken forward. Then I think we should be able to see a lot of, you know, our software companies are some of the best in the world, some of the best. So it is easy, not a unachievable target. It is achievable, provided that focus is on maybe government and the private sector together will have to do that, not only the government. India has gone because India's revolution started in the early 80s. In the early 80s, they identified that one of the things that they can do better than anyone else in the world is to put money on IT. So they set up what are called IITs. Now, if you take Indian Institute of Technology, it is something that produces some of the best software engineers. By the time they come to the third year, they are grabbed. Fourth year, they are in a job. To that extent, they are marketable. Some of the top class companies in the US are managed by Indians. That is because they are the people who learned in that 80-90 era. So India has a lead over us of 20-30 years. We are only just starting. So even if you don't get to the level of India, it's possible that we can also become a giant in this, given our small number. We are 21 million, India is 1 billion. So take those numbers, we are 1/50th of India, don't forget that. So, at least this 20 million, I think we could easily have 1 million IT personnel, 1/20th of our population, and be IT savvy, real IT top level guys, like software engineers, top level programmers, so they can easily find jobs anywhere in the world. The capability is here, the potential is here. What may be lacking is maybe the focus. So that is why if you look at the vision of the Ministry of Higher Education, they have also said that IT is one of their key outcomes that they expect. So I believe if we go the way we are going now, we should be able to reach that target. History is not that long, e-government history is fairly short, but I think we have done fairly well. I don't say we have done excellently well, but I think fairly well. The whole purpose of e-government is to use ICT for the benefit of the citizen. That is the whole purpose of e-government. It's really not to help the administrator, it is to help the people. Now, I will just take one example. 20-30 years ago, even just 5 years back, or even maybe about 6 or 7 years back, if you wanted to get a copy of your birth certificate, you had to wait, because you had to go there, they had to check it, you know, make sure that the bundle is right, so then check the whole thing with your application, it may not even be found, so many problems, and sometimes people have said, no, I can't find my birth certificate. But today this is just 5 minutes, or maybe 10. Why? ICT has made it possible. Two things. One, they scanned all the records and put it into a database. So you put your name, with that name, if there are others, they are all birth certificates will come out. And you say you are born on such a high date. Okay, then they will just finally, this is your birth certificate, yes, they can go. Just 10 minutes actually. So it has made life so easy. And I think e-government is also working efficiently on databases. You don't keep on asking the same question again and again and again. That's what normal government forms are. You don't have to do that. The government, you ask Mahavan, it's there. The national identity cards will soon be fully automated, computerized, so that it will come out of a process, not just the way it is done now. Passports have become extremely fast. They don't take much time. Very quickly issued. Motor car licensing, very quick. If you go for your revenue license for your vehicle, it doesn't take more than 1 minute. In fact, like, you know, where they give McDonald's food, drive-in through counter, they have a drive-in through counter at Maligavat. So you go and just, you know, drive through, give a document, you get your license within 3-4 minutes. So I think we can be proud about what we have done, but there are a lot more to do, lot more. Salaries are all paid through computing packages. Pensions are being used. Pensions are being paid by using ICT packages. But there are a lot more other things that needs to be done. So ICT agency, one of the arms, if you study their structure, one arm is e-government. But they don't call it e-government, we deliberately change it. We call it re-engineering government. Now re-engineering government is a very interesting concept. When you start management, you know it. This is in the early 90s. They said governments are too big, governments are too complex, governments are not easy to work with, make it simple. So they went through what is called a process engineering. They looked at all the process. Okay, how much time do you take to issue a passport? What are the steps that can be eliminated? Where is automation taking place? Can this form be automated? Can this form be put on the web? So basically that's what it was all about. So e-government and e-government's governance will help Sri Lanka a lot. As it is now, people are now using more emails, people are now using more web-based applications. Today you can work. I don't need to really go to office. I can work from home, but we need to go to office for other reasons. I can work through my emails. I can get everybody online, and then maybe whatever questions I want to ask, they can mail me whatever documents they want to send me, scan and send me whatever documents. So very, very useful, and I think it is making a revolution in the country. But it hasn't come to the point where it will make a real revolution. The real revolution is people don't come to government offices at all. You do all your government transactions from a kiosk or an internet cafe, or if you don't have a computer at home, or go to a nanasala. That is why we are trying to have 14,000 nanasalas all over the country. Is there any villager, any person will go to the nanasala, get his work done, file your tax, file whatever documentation that you need to apply for a passport, apply for your maybe to get your exam results. Today exam results are, you know, on the web, so they will go and look at it. Otherwise you'll have to go to school and listen to the principal, you know, reading out your results. It took a long time those days. So many things are happening. And today people are now reading books on the computer. So someday you will not have bookshops. You will have e-bookshops. That's how I see it. I don't know. It might happen. You were talking about university students, right? So university students have a huge role to play. Rather than shouting slogans and, you know, making your life more difficult, that's a learning time. That is where you really cut your teeth. You are one among maybe 10,000 or whatever out of a 500,000 or number, I don't know the large numbers that are sitting now A levels. Of that group, you are the elite. You have been selected out of very difficult exam. A level is a, you know, do or die battle for children. It is becoming more and more difficult. In my time, it was not that difficult. You get four simple passes, you are in the medical faculty, or if you get one more as a credit or whatever, then you are in the engineering faculty. Very simple. There are many kids who just got three passes and came into the science faculty. Many. So, yours is very difficult. You got 3 years, then you don't know where you will go until you see, because there is so much of results course and whatever. But I think a university student's main responsibility is, you know, this time that is given to you will never come back. Never in life. Never. You come to the jobs that we do, you will never hardly find any time to read. So here is the time to gather knowledge. By gathering knowledge, you sharpen your skills. You prepare yourself for a job. Why do you do that? Only not for earning money. You prepare to contribute to the country's development. So that is where the best students are. They are the people, they are the thinkers, they are the doctors, they are the engineers, they are the scientists, they are the IT fellows, people who can conceptualize, architects, everybody is there. So unless that time is made use of, and also you know knowledge is expanding by the second. Today what you and I know will become redundant in the next second. So fast. Somebody would have found a new program, somebody would have come out with a new concept. Management theories that you learn will be totally out within the next 2 weeks. That's the kind of thing. Now leadership theories which we learned 25 years ago are no longer valid. Now they are talking about something else today. So knowledge is changing and we are not changing. So what should a university student do? Basically, keep a track of this change in knowledge. How does knowledge change so fast? Keep a track. Difficult. But if you don't do that, you come out of the university not knowing anything. You can't handle. No, I think there's one other message that I need to give. University education, except in professional courses like medicine and engineering and architecture, which are, you know, maybe quantity surveying. You do medicine, you become a doctor. You do engineering, different engineering fields, mechanical to civil to telecom to whatever. But larger number, like maybe you go into the faculties of social sciences, humanities, the arts faculties, management faculties, IT faculties, commerce and all these things. There are no specific job that you can get, but you should be able to get any job. That is the whole idea of going for the university. I am not doing physics now anymore. I am not doing any chemistry. Nor am I doing any botany. But I am using the things that I learned in those three subjects: ability to think, ability to analyze, ability to comprehend, think outside the box. Because maybe you are given a problem in physics, there is no one particular way to solve it. You are trying to find different ways and the best way. So, in government also that's what we are doing. I am trying to find the best ways to solve problems for the people. not what my predecessor did. It may not be the best. So I'm trying to find the best one. But to do that, I have to train my mind. I can't be training my mind now. I should have trained my mind at your age. So unless I don't have that, unless I have that kind of, you know, space in my mind to learn, to absorb, to change my thinking, I am not a useful administrator. So basically my advice to the university students will be, don't listen to people who want to destroy societies. Listen to people who have knowledge. They give you knowledge. Look at knowledge. Oh, is this applicable to our country? No. How should I change it? Oh, this is the way to change it. That is the purpose of a university. So make the best use of this opportunity. And don't prolong your stay in the university from 2-3 years to 5 years to 6 years. You are wasting country's money, you are wasting your parents' money, you are wasting your money, your time. That time can never be taken back. So that is a strong message I like to give the student community. You will realize only the usefulness of your university when you are in positions, when you are in jobs. Oh, I didn't learn this, I didn't learn that, therefore I am not aware, so therefore I am not good for this job. So that shouldn't happen to any student. I was trying to in fact define what a Sri Lankan citizen should be doing in a lecture that I did some time back, I forget. I wrote down characteristics of a good Sri Lankan. I think number one is that all the countries in the world are looking at their own countries. You look at an Indian, I'm taking this because I think that's a very strong message that I see. They're very patriotic, they love the country. You go to Japan, they love their country. When you love the country, what do? You do your best. You try to give your best. You're not bothered about time, you're not bothered about what you get. What can I do for my country is the question that you ask. You don't go and, you know, you go to a beautiful place, you don't take something out of your pocket and, you know, litter the place, you know, put some dirt there. You don't do that. You love your country. If you don't love your country, you can do that. So basically, I think citizens must learn, we are a small country, 21 million people, resources are limited. How do we keep this country going, not only for ourselves, you know, generations to come? I have seen two generations come and coming. So I must make sure that any future generation also should be able to use these resources better. So what do? We hand over to the next generation a better country. That is the purpose of a citizen. So for that you need to be knowledgeable, you need to be educated. Why are we putting so much money on education? Why are we harping on education? Why are we having universities? Why are we having technical colleges? Why are we having youth centers trying to guide people? That is all because I think you need a good citizen. A good citizen can look after this country. Then Sri Lanka will always be governed by Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka will never be governed by foreigners. Not anymore, I don't think so. Well, we were under colonial powers for 500 years, from 1505 to 1948. So it's a long time, 43 years. So it's one has to look at that seriously and think, what is my contribution to the country? That is the job of a citizen. And protect and look after. Because I can't think of management without IT. If you produce graduates in management not knowing IT, or at least conversant in IT, they will only become managers who are very, you know, close. But if you know IT also, you bring IT skills into your management, then you become a good manager. It's easy to manage. I don't think I can do what I do without understanding what IT is, or the things that I use in my work. I just simply can't even just keep a track. So I think management and IT must go together. But also IT must be taught, I think, from young ages. What I feel is very small children today use ICT very well. So you must get them to use. I think my basic understanding is, if someone were to ask me the same question and say, you know, can you write down? I would like to be known as someone, maybe number one, who loves this country. That is very important. Number two is to say that I like people doing well. I like people doing well. And I like people learning all the time. So basically, I would like to be known as a facilitator, maybe someone who wants to promote others' welfare, who wants to work for this country. And maybe also one tagline which I started with, not bothered about recognition. So I think that's a key thing that I am. That is why I'm an extremely happy person, extremely. That is because I don't worry about credit. Worry about recognition. If someone were to say, I don't care about it. Does it matter to me? If I know I have done what I have to do, I don't need a certificate. I only need a certificate if I go for an exam. Well, there you need to be certified, no? Yes, passed. That is the only time I need a certificate. And I think I have enough certificates now. I don't need any more.